Professor Noveck is Florence Rogatz Visiting Professor and Director of the Governance Lab at Yale Law School. She's the Jerry Halton Global Network Professor at New York University's Tandon School of Engineering and Director of the Gov Lab and its MacArthur Research Network on Opening Governance. Professor Noveck focuses her research, teaching, and activism on the impact of technology on public institutions and solving public problems. A graduate of Harvard University and Yale Law School, welcome home, she is a member of the advisory board of the Open Contracting Partnership and is program committee member of the 2016 conferences on international open data research, data science for government, and the data for good exchange. Welcome.
Thank you. Let's see, do I have a deck here? No, we'll just change that. I have this for other reasons. I'll tell you what, I'll start. Well, if you don't mind, I'll let you put my deck up, and that way we will. Let me start, it's under Noveck, I hope, or somewhere, by saying I am delighted to be here, and I'm here first and foremost just to meet the people in the room and to enjoy the fellowship of people who have so much in common, and also to report, because it wasn't on the list that was up earlier, that we now have an open data clinic at Yale Law School as well. Where we have lots of students working on and eager to work on open data related policy projects. So I'm here a little bit as the lawyer in the room, don't all now leave at once, but to talk about the legal and ethical and policy side of some of this work. Again, there's a lot that has already been covered, so I will try not to repeat unduly. But I want to pick up on a point that was made earlier, perhaps in jest. So I was the head of open government and open data at OSTP, so you have me to blame for some of those unfunded mandates. And the throwaway comment that you made about the end of open science and open government and open data in the White House, I want to make sure to bring that back to the fore, because though it was funny, as we know, it's really not funny. And so I want to make sure that we're at least focused on, and the one thing that we take away from this is that as much as we're excited about the technologies of big data, as much as we're eager to talk, as we will today and as the students showed yesterday, about the many important things we can do with the data that's available, it's not simply the tools that are making possible everything we're talking about, it's the policies that underlie them, and that obviously runs through the conversation. So it's the fact that we now have a policy of open data at the national level in the United States, and that next week 70 countries will meet for the Open Government Partnership in Paris, 70 countries who have signed on to commitments to open up their data, to create data portals at the national, at the state, at the local level. 15 of those countries have now signed on to an international open data charter in which they are making commitments. What I'm looking for is the exact language, which I won't find at the moment, in which they are going to make commitments to essentially publish all data in digital format, downloadable, open to the public a priori. So we still have a long way to go to realize the vision, but at least we have the cornerstone in terms of policy that started with President Obama's memorandum on his very first day in office, a memorandum on transparency and open government, in which he said that the data collected by the government, paid for by our taxpayer dollars, collected in the government's practice as regulator and as researcher, belongs to us. It was very controversial, I might add, at the time. It seems obvious to us now, but it was very controversial, the idea that we weren't simply focusing on data about the workings of government, such as the money that it spends or the salaries of public officials, but that in fact we would try to open up all the data that could power things like the innovations that we are talking about today. And then going beyond the idea of just a policy of just words, the creation of platforms that actually allow us to put data somewhere, to have a place for people to find that data so that we can go beyond the promise and make the practice real in principle. There's great things that it's allowing us to do in terms of transforming how government works. So when they put up the school spending data in Mexico on Mejora tu Escuela, we can see right away that 1,512 people all on the payroll all have the same birth date. They're all 102 years old, and they all make more than the president of Mexico. So it allows us to, yes, improve government accountability, but it also, in the end, allows parents to make better choices. And ultimately, it's not a story about the data, and it's not a story about the platforms, even, as we know, and as you so well pointed out, it's about the communities that we build around the data. So in Rajasthan, in India, the group MKSS has, for the last decade, been taking government spending data, budget data, and painting it on the walls of villages and holding readings, theatrical performances in which they read the budget. If that doesn't sound exciting, I don't know what does. But what they do is then they ask people, where is the bridge built to nowhere? Where is the person who's died who's still on the payroll? And through that mechanism, using data as the raw material, co-create the process of and the practice of greater accountability in government. So I want to just spend a couple of minutes on talking about another sort of development. You're all very familiar with kind of the movement around open data. The one, though, that I want to emphasize that we have to continue to fight for. We cannot, especially now, take it as a given or take it for granted. The two leading countries, the US and the UK, that spearheaded this movement have both had a change of administration, neither of which seem poised to invest in this agenda. That's a best case scenario, is that they ignore it. But we all know that the reality is that we might see significant rollbacks on the opening up of data and investments in open data, since it costs real money to actually do it. What we are seeing, though, is a rise of what many people call social corporate data philanthropy, or what we call data collaboratives. Bloomberg just had a big conference on data science for social good, in which many companies came committing to open up their data. And we know that part of the clinical trial story, part of what so many people in this room have been fighting for, is to not only get the clinical trials data from NIH, but to also get it directly from the companies that are producing this data. So, you know, it's Twitter providing its fire hose of data to the University of Wollongong in Australia, and then using that, the university using that to create flood maps to help promote resilience, excuse me, in Indonesia. So we're seeing lots of ways in which open data, including data that comes from government, data that comes from researchers, data that comes from companies, through collaboration often between these three parties, that's what we call data collaboratives. It's at that intersection that a lot of exciting work is happening. I only have a few minutes today to talk about this, so I would point you to a website that we've created called OD Impact, Open Data's Impact. Where we're collecting case studies and in-depth stories, but also then analysis of these examples of open data. We have another project with USAID focused on those that work in the development context as well, that's all going up here. And I might add, to your point, this is fully open source and replicable, and a number of people have already forked this to create their own archives and repositories of open data impact stories. Since so much of this work, as you said earlier, is about telling the story of impact, not just talking about the promise. So I want to fly through a couple of examples that, again, I think for you, this is a room that needs no convincing. But I think it's important to at least share a little bit of the story about the ways in which we are transforming not only science, but we're transforming government and other sectors through open data. And then to end with a couple of just thoughts on the policy side of this. So obviously, we can do lots of great stuff now in terms of our ability to provide services, especially to vulnerable people, by monitoring populations in real time. So when we open up things like the national oceanic and atmospheric data, we can do things like better predict the weather. And a lot of that data, though, some of it's coming from the government, as we know, but some of that data also then comes from companies. So it's Intel opening up data that collects off of sensors that it's using. And the combination of data is allowing us to create new tools that help to promote resilience. We can, as we saw with the Mejora Tu Escuela example, also improve how government spends money and government efficiency and government effectiveness. As was mentioned, I'm on the board of a nonprofit called the Open Contracting Partnership, which works with governments around the world to open up their contracting and spending data. By the way, the data's open, but we need people to look at it and use it if we're going to actually spot the fraud, waste, and abuse. At the very least, what it's starting to do is to decrease a culture of corruption in places like Slovakia, the Ukraine, which interestingly is very out ahead in the last year on open contracting data, and Mexico and elsewhere. But we're seeing this move towards government using its own data to actually decrease its spending and become more accountable. We're seeing then, of course, the ability to use this data to solve major social problems. So we have problems hiding in plain sight, like that in Zanesville, Ohio, where when you actually scrutinize the data, you discover that clean water is being delivered. There's a redlining problem. If you live in a neighborhood that is white, you're receiving clean city water. If you live in a neighborhood that's traditionally African American, you are not. This led to then a lawsuit, a change in the situation, damages to the that were paid to the victims. But it would not have been possible without open data about city water services, about city water practices that allow us then to spot this kind of unfairness and to rectify major social problems. And so we're also seeing, obviously, lots of use of data collection, and this is particularly important where citizen science comes in terms of using people on the ground as data collectors. We're seeing, incidentally, a lot of that use of citizens as data collectors now as monitors of rises of hate incidents and bias incidents, as you've seen lots of efforts by different groups to collect data about hate crimes and rises of incidents of hate that are occurring. So the collection of data, particularly by citizens, that we can use when made open, as Christchurch New Zealand did, to be able then to figure out which buildings are about to fall down, where can people move back in, how do we actually rebuild the city. So the CIO of Christchurch New Zealand was in fact very out ahead on using open data, and then that collaboration and partnership with citizens, both to collect the data, but also to scrutinize the data to be able to develop solutions in real times. And again, what you see is a lot of this work happening now at the intersection between government and private companies, because especially in a lot of developing world contexts, there is no administrative state infrastructure. There isn't that data being collected by government. And so we need to depend on the work of groups like Real Impact Analytics and Twitter and others who have the data and push them to make it available so that we can do this kind of social good work more efficiently and effectively. My lab has a partnership with UNICEF. Over the next year and a half, we'll be working, we have both worked to define the problems that UNICEF works on in terms of improving children's lives, and then trying to find the partners that we can turn to in countries that don't have a census, that don't have a data collection infrastructure, or where we might A, create one using citizen scientists, or B, use data that companies are anyway collecting. Finally, the last example that I want to give, and it's an example that we frequently use when we have a hard time convincing people of the need to open up their data. We can see how it works with provosts. I know how it works with prime ministers, which is you tell them not that open data is the right thing to do. You don't tell them about solving social problems and helping flood victims and babies and children. You tell them it'll create jobs and promote economic growth. You tell them about how New York City is using open data to create a business atlas that gives the small business owner the same kind of market research information about where to site their jewelry store or their coffee shop as the Starbucks or the Gap has. We have a project called the Open Data 500, which has been tracking, and this, by the way, is Open Data 500 is in the US, and then we have a bunch of other countries that we're partnered with labs in other places tracking businesses that use open data to create jobs. And we're working with scholars at Columbia Business School to track the investment in those businesses, and their research shows that, in fact, businesses driven by open data, perhaps surprisingly, in fact, receive no less investment than people who used closed assets and closed resources. In fact, they do just as well. And there's a tremendous number of exciting stories about how companies, and back to your point about creating the commercial layer on top of these services, the fact that in this country, unlike in many others, we have a policy which says you can reuse the data, including for commercial purposes, helps to create jobs. So let me just, sort of wind up. I have no idea what time it is. We have a couple more minutes. So ultimately, I think the biggest benefit, and we know this from the science case, but we also see it as much in the government case, it's so both in terms of reproducibility in all of these contexts, is what we do is we get more eyeballs on a problem. So by opening up the data, we can then get, which one is this one? We can then get election watchers. We can then create a crowdsourcing project, as the Kawal Pamilu project did, using open election data to then, in a project that I might add, cost something on the order of $57 and was done in about, you know, a week. These stories are all so wonderful about how cheap they are. We're then able to scrutinize election results for fraud, et cetera. So let me, I'm going to skip ahead because I want to talk about the challenges. So how do we realize this benefit, whether in the government context or in the science context? Obviously, we need to continue to push, and that's part of the, that's the entire impetus for this event today. We need to push for the policies against data-hugging disorder, against data-hoarding disorder. But we have to do it in all of these sectors, and we have to do it in all of them in tandem, because we need the collaboration between them if we're to realize the social benefits from having the data. So we need to keep pushing on the government side, but we need to also do this work with companies, with research institutes, et cetera, in order to realize these benefits. It's not, though, all a story about open data. Right? And we know very well, particularly for people who are doing human subjects research, who are doing biomedical research, this is also a story about the 50 shades of gray in between closed and open, namely responsible data access and data governance, knowing how to share data in reliable and responsible ways. So I was very proud that my students yesterday got to present a poster on work that they're doing with two jurisdictions now in Lafayette Parish, Louisiana, and Cottington County, South Dakota, on their governance practices for sharing data between their criminal justice and mental health agencies, helping them to work through that process and develop a toolkit and kind of a map for how to do that so they can, in turn, reduce incarceration by diverting the mentally ill out of jail or prison and into treatment. That can only be done through data sharing, but that has to be done in ways that are legally compliant, that are ethically compliant, where they actually know what IT to use, unlike one of the jurisdictions, which simply emails a spreadsheet of everybody from one agency to another, which we know is not the best way to do it. So there's a whole range of issues that intertwine the technical and the legal and the ethical that are really questions of data governance that are at the center of a lot of the work that we see happening. There's fabulous work being done now by the UN's Food Lab and the UN Hunger Program on collecting data about Syrian refugees and their consumption of food in the camps. But they can't simply publish and visualize this data lest they make the people they're trying to help potential targets and victims of crime and attack. So there are lots of difficult ethical questions that people are debating. And in this country where we have launched, we announced it last year, and about 120 days ago, the checks were dispersed in the Precision Medicine Initiative. We have this great hope that we will start to collect longitudinal data from 1 million people, not just about their genetics, but now about their cultural practices, their environmental practices, what they do. And to do that data, to collect it effectively, we have to know responsibly how to handle it. It's great if we have 10 years of data on people that can allow us to quickly spot that I might be at the risk of diabetes. But it's terrible if, by virtue of that surveillance, I suddenly start getting coupons for Big Macs. Then we're doing something wrong. We're doing something wrong if we're not then also putting the people at the center of the process and ensuring that in that research we are prioritizing the needs and the conditions of the people who are most underserved and underrepresented in biomedical research. I'm glad to report that in the Precision Medicine Initiative, they have taken extra steps to create a national level IRB with a high degree of diversity in that IRB to ensure exactly that, that people and their privacy is being put at the center. So let me stop because I want to make sure we have some time for questions and just say that as we talk about all the fabulous things that we can do with big data in the sciences, that we must put the policies of privacy, of openness, of ethical and responsible sharing, and of governance at the center. And so with all that, I make a case for the lawyers and why we're very happy to be part of this conversation. Thank you.